This is Business Analytics Using Forecasting, and I'm Galit Shmueli. This video is going to conclude the long journey that we've taken through the forecasting land. Let's see where we were and try to put the pieces together. The most important takeaway from here is that forecasting is not a function in a software. It's an entire process that requires a lot more than just technical knowledge. It starts from defining the goal, talks about data issues, exploration, patterns and series, pre-processing and partitioning series so that we can evaluate them, a whole host of forecasting methods, and of course, we need to keep in mind implementation throughout the entire process. In the first week, we focused on different types of goals that call for forecasting. We discussed the importance of properly identifying what the forecast will be used for, and then use this information for determining whether the goal is predictive or descriptive, what is the required forecast horizon, how the forecast will be delivered, and more. We also saw several interviews with stakeholders that can benefit from forecasting. We started looking at data and discussed issues related to availability and delays. We talked about the difference between the dynamic nature of a time series in contrast to the frozen nature of the file in which the data is stored. This difference causes several challenges. We then jumped into data exploration and visualization. We discussed the different types of patterns common in time series, such as different types of trends and seasonality patterns. And we used a powerful data visualization tool, Tableau, to try and identify patterns and exceptions in the time series. One series that we examined was the daily ridership on Taipei Metro. We learned that visualization and data exploration can lead to different pre-processing approaches for the data, such as aggregating from daily to monthly, breaking down the data by month, removing an earlier period that's different, and more. In week three, the topic was performance evaluation. We discussed the important principle of partitioning a series into training and validation periods to mimic the forecasting scenario. And we talked about the difference between model fit and predictive performance. We also distinguished between two types of partitioning, fixed partitioning and roll-forward partitioning. We then talked about the naive forecast and the seasonal naive forecast, which are always useful as a benchmark for more complicated models and, in fact, are sometimes very hard to beat. We introduced performance charts and metrics based on the forecast errors. We looked at these separately for training and for validation periods and used them to evaluate a model as well as to compare models. Finally, we discussed prediction intervals as an important component of reporting forecasts and how to obtain them from the error distribution. In weeks 4 to 6, we introduced several types of forecasting methods. In week 4, we looked at smoothing methods. We started with a centered moving average, which is useful for data visualization. We then looked at the trailing moving average for forecasting. We saw that it's not a good idea to apply to a series with trend and/or seasonality. That motivated our discussion of differencing as an operation that helps remove trend and seasonality. The other smoothing methods that we saw belong to the exponential smoothing family. We saw simple exponential smoothing, Holt's exponential smoothing, and Winter's exponential smoothing. These different variations differ in their abilities to capture trend and seasonality. In all cases, they rely on taking a weighted average of past values so that weights decay exponentially into the past. Finally, we discussed prediction intervals for exponential smoothing methods, as well as automation. We concluded that the specialty of these methods is that they're cheap to compute, easy to automate, and can fit local patterns that change over time. In weeks 5 and 6, we introduced the use of regression models for forecasting. We started by looking at how to capture different trend shapes and seasonality patterns using predictors such as a running index or season dummy variables. We then introduced the concept of autocorrelation, how to measure it, and how to use autoregressive models to improve forecasts in series that do have autocorrelation. Lastly, we looked at ARMA and ARIMA models, which are a flexible family of models that capture a wide variety of autocorrelation structures in a time series. We discussed automation of such methods and their pros and cons. In our last set of videos, we looked at different types of external information that we might want to include, and how we can use them as input into regression models for potentially improving our forecast. We looked at holidays, we looked at outliers, and we looked at correlated and causal series. This concludes our journey. I hope that now you see why we call this course not just forecasting or time series forecasting, but instead we called it business analytics using forecasting. Tying the analytics problem with the business or domain problem is critical for creating solutions that are actually practical, useful, and implementable. I hope you've enjoyed the learning and that you will be able to use this and implement this in the future.